Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Royal Society. My name is Paul Nurse. I'm president of the Royal Society, and I want to welcome all of you in the room and also those that we cannot see who are in the two overflow rooms. This has proven to be, as we might imagine, an extremely popular event. And for that matter, all of those around the world who will be watching this at this moment in time on the internet. So welcome to all of you as well. Now, I'm going in a moment to introduce Brian Cox. But first, before I actually say a few words about him, I'm going to present him with a cheque, a prize and a certificate, because he has won the Royal Society Michael Faraday Prize, which is the UK's foremost award for excellence in communicating science to the public. So I'm going to ask Brian if he could come up here, and I will try and find the pieces I have to give you. So Brian, why don't we come here so you can be photographed? So we have... you're not used to that, are you? Yeah, there we go. So I'm going to congratulate Brian.
Thank you. Yes, thanks.
So I'm going to just say a few words. Stay up.
Oh, shall I say that?
Might as well stay, because you're going
to... look embarrassed.
You can look embarrassed, because you're about to perform. So this year, we are awarding, the Royal Society is awarding Brian Cox, Professor Brian Cox, the Faraday Prize. It is the 27th time that it's been awarded. It's a very distinguished award, and there's a number of previous winners in the audience. Brian is a particle physicist, an active particle physicist. He's a Royal Society University Research Fellow. That is the award that the Royal Society gives to younger researchers. It's like a career development award. And he's a professor at the University of Manchester. He works primarily on the ATLAS experiment at CERN. That's the big proton collider in Geneva. And his research interests have been focused in recent years on ATLAS, but he's also worked at DAISY, that's another accelerator in Hamburg, on the H1 experiment there, and on the D0 experiment, which is on the Tevatron collider at Fermilab in Chicago, which used to be the most powerful collider before CERN. But this award is for his absolutely outstanding achievements, extraordinary achievements, in popularising science via numerous television documentaries, radio shows, live science shows, public lectures, books, newspaper articles, and face-to-face interaction with school children and with teachers. An extraordinary battery of different sorts of events, all of which have been extremely successful. He also demonstrates dedication, and this is very important for us all, to influencing politicians and science funders in supporting science. And he remains fully committed, as I said, to his research in particle physics. So it gives me great pleasure to invite Brian to deliver his Michael Faraday Prize lecture. And I'm now going to hand over to you, Brian.
Thanks. Thanks, Paul. Thank you. Thank you, Paul. It's it's a great honour to be awarded this prize. In the name of Michael Faraday, this is a very famous picture of Faraday at the Royal Institution, just up the road, delivering the Christmas lectures. In this lecture, what I want to do is to describe why, first of all, I became a scientist. I want to present and actually read. I've actually brought some books with me. I want to read out some of the passages of science writing that inspired me to become a scientist. And I also want to say why I think that the communication of science is absolutely vital for Britain, and why I think that the work, which arguably began here in London in 1799 with the Royal Institution, is so important, not just for Britain, actually, but for the progress of our civilization. And finally, if you saw, I wrote a small op-ed piece in the Times today, which was really about a dream that I have. What would I dream about? What would be the Britain that I could, if I ruled the country, what would I do? How would I make my utopia in Britain? So at the end, I want to really deliver almost a kind of a fake speech, a speech that I hope somebody, one of the party leaders, delivers on the eve of the 2015 election, outlining how we will make Britain the best place in the world to do science. So, as I mentioned, and I'm going to start my timer now, there we are, after the introduction, this is Michael Faraday. Faraday, as you see here, is giving one of the Christmas lectures at the Royal Institution. Faraday is an interesting man. I want to get his dates right, so I've written them down. He was born in 1791, the son of a blacksmith in Yorkshire. So he wasn't born to be a scientist in some sense. He left school at 14, he was self-taught. But when he was 20, he came down to London and he attended a lecture by Humphrey Davy. Now, Humphrey Davy is probably most famous for inventing the Davy safety lamp, which revolutionised the safety of mining. But he was also a president of the Royal Institution, a president of the Royal Society, and one of the, I suppose, first genuinely charismatic popularisers of science. He inspired Faraday to write letters to him. Faraday actually wrote down one of his lectures and sent it to Davy as a job application to be a scientific secretary. And eventually Davy relented and appointed Faraday to a position at the Royal Institution. Not long after that, Faraday revolutionised the modern world. He essentially discovered the law of electromagnetic induction. He noticed by doing experiments that if you take a coil of wire and you push a bar magnet into the coil of wire, then when you're moving the magnet through the coil, a current flows in the wire. He also noticed that if you change a current in a wire, so if you switch the current on and off, then momentarily, as you do that, a compass needle is deflected near the wire, which means that there's a magnetic field changing near the wire. These are the foundations of generation of electricity and the electric motor, which revolutionised the 21st century. They went on to inspire a man called James Clerk Maxwell to build the theoretical framework that unifies those rather disparate phenomena of electricity and magnetism together. If you think about it, it's not at all obvious why the current in a wire that's illuminating these lights now should have anything to do with the fridge magnet that sits on the wall of your fridge. Maxwell, building on the work of Faraday, showed that they're intimately connected. In doing so, Maxwell showed that there are things, objects, if you like, called electric and magnetic fields, which oscillate and push themselves together through space at the speed of light. So he showed that light was a wave in electric and magnetic fields, an electromagnetic wave. From that, Einstein took at face value what Maxwell showed theoretically, based on the work of Faraday, that the speed of light is a constant for all observers. That, inspired Einstein, or was the clue Einstein needed to build his theories of special and general relativity, which to this day stand, general relativity is our best theory of gravity, and special relativity, from which you get E equals mc squared, underpins all our fundamental theories of the way the universe works. Very important point, the fact that beginning with Faraday, inspired by Humphrey Davy at the Royal Institution, you have a chain of events which could not have been predicted, but which led essentially to the modern world. Virtually everything you do now, from the transistor to GPS satellite navigation, at some level, our understanding of those phenomena is based on relativity, quantum mechanics, electricity and magnetism, all the things which really, were started here in London in many ways back in 1799. So I just want to read you something, because, as I've said, the Royal Institution, it was founded in 1799 by Banks, who was a president of the Royal Society for many years, Cavendish, and a strange man called Count Rumsford of Bavaria, actually. He made his fortune boring cannon for the count in Bavaria, a very strange guy who was born in Boston. Complete aside, nothing to do with this lecture at all, but interesting nonetheless. Cavendish also was rather interesting, by the way. One of the most eccentric men ever, to be scientists. He wore a three-cornered hat, which was considered extremely unfashionable even in 1799. He was out of date in 1799. The stories about him are endless. One is that he had a staircase built at the back of his house in order so that he could go up and only he could use it, so he wouldn't bump into his housekeeper because he was so afraid of women. Stereotypical scientist. But anyway, the three of them set this process in motion. They founded the Royal Institution. And I was there a few months ago now, actually, filming a series for the BBC, and they took me into the archive, and they showed me the original founding document of the Royal Institution, which is a remarkable thing. I think it was mainly written by Joseph Banks, who, by the way, was famous for... cut his scientific teeth on a round-the-world voyage with Captain Cook to look at the transit of Venus back in the 1750s, 1760s. But anyway, Banks wrote this. This was the reason the Royal Institution was founded. And I think it's as relevant today as it was back then, all those years ago. It says, and let me just show you the front of that document. Beautiful thing. It says, this is the first line. So here you see the cover page of the founding document. The Royal Institution of Great Britain, for diffusing the knowledge and facilitating the general introduction of useful mechanical inventions and improvements, and for teaching, by courses of philosophical lectures and experiments, the application of science to the common purposes of life. And the first page says this: it's an undoubted truth that the successive improvements in the condition of man, from a state of ignorance and barbarism to that of the highest cultivation and refinement, are usually effected by the aid of machinery in procuring the necessaries, the comforts, and the elegances of life, and that the preeminence of any people in civilization is and ought ever to be estimated by the state of industry and mechanical improvement among them. It's a statement about discovery, about invention, and about what it does for people's lives, how it changes people's lives. And the final passage in this prospectus, which was really to raise money for science and for the promotion of science, as I've said, virtually immediately it gave us Faraday, which essentially gave us the modern world, so it worked. The last statement, the last sentence is this. It says, when the rich shall take pleasure. I think that's to be read really is when the politically powerful today, when the politically powerful take pleasure. So when the rich shall take pleasure in contemplating and encouraging such mechanical improvements as are really useful, good taste with its inseparable companion, good morals will revive. Rational economy will become fashionable. Industry and ingenuity will be honoured and rewarded, and the pursuits of all the various classes of society will then tend to promote the public prosperity. It's a statement which is as valid today as it is now. What it's saying is that if we live in a society in which everybody delights in the acquisition of knowledge, exploration, research are cherished, then it's almost like trickle-down economics, but it's trickle-down knowledge. Then everybody will benefit from that generation of new knowledge. That's a remarkable thing. It was radical at the time because it was written in 1799, and it's still as radical today, which is one of the reasons I think you may have read in the press that the Royal Institution is having some problems. There's the famous building in Albemarle Street, which is still there. It's one of the reasons I think it's absolutely essential to save it, because its message, which has been shown to be correct by the vast amount of science that's come out of that building and the vast amount of scientists that were inspired by the things, including the Christmas lectures that came out of that building, I think it's absolutely vital that we save it. And the first reading I would like to give you from one of the books that inspired me is from one of my great heroes, Carl Sagan. There's a picture of Carl Sagan. I love this picture. I say, don't ever think that the Mars landings were faked. Here's the proof. that's the Viking lander, by the way, not the one. Two of them landed on Mars. That's a third mock-up, which I think is in the Mojave Desert somewhere. Sagan, I'm going to mention him throughout this lecture, but he wrote very powerfully about why does science need to be shared? You saw that in what I read from Banks. Banks, Cavendish, Rumsford, Faraday, they knew that science had to be shared. They had this idea that by sharing it, you encourage people to support it and it gets done. But Sagan had another beautiful image, a picture of why it should be shared and what happens if you don't share it, if you don't democratise the knowledge that we gather here in places like the Royal Society. In his book Cosmos, he's talking about Alexandria, one of the great cities of the ancient world, and I think this is a beautiful passage. Alexandria was the greatest city in the Western world had ever seen. People of all nations came to live there, to trade, to learn. On any given day, its harbours were thronged with merchants, scholars and tourists. This was a city where Greeks, Egyptians, Arabs, Syrians, Hebrews, Persians, Nubians, Phoenicians, Italians, Gauls and Iberians exchanged merchandise and ideas. It's probably here that the word cosmopolitan realised its true meaning. Citizen, not just of a nation, but of the cosmos. To be a citizen of the cosmos. Here, clearly, were the seeds of the modern world. What prevented them from taking root and flourishing? Why instead did the West slumber through 1,000 years of darkness until Columbus and Copernicus and their contemporaries rediscovered the work done in Alexandria? I can't give you a simple answer, but I do know this. There is no record in the entire history of the library that any of its illustrious scientists and scholars ever challenged the political, economic, and religious assumptions of their society. The permanence of the stars was questioned. The justice of slavery was not. Science and learning in general were the preserve of a privileged few. The vast population of the city had not the vaguest notion of the great discoveries taking place within the library. New findings were not explained or popularized. The research benefited them little. Discoveries in mechanics and steam technology were applied mainly to the perfection of weapons, the encouragement of superstition, the amusement of kings. The scientists never grasped the potential of machines to free people. The great intellectual achievements of antiquity had few immediate practical applications. Science never captured the imagination of the multitude. There was no counterbalance to stagnation, to pessimism, to the most abject surrenders to mysticism. When, at long last, the mob came to burn the library down, there was nobody to stop them. Maybe that's what we should think about with the Royal Institution. In any case, I want to tell you, or take you through a timeline of my life, my inspirations. I've mentioned one of them, Carl Sagan. But this, I thought, was a useful graph because it spans my life. I was born in 1968, which is about here, when, interestingly, investment in science in Britain was rather higher than it is now. I'm just using it as a backdrop. I'm making no political comment at all. This is just my timeline. And we end up here in 2007-08, and actually investment is planned to be relatively flat, which is, I suppose, something of a victory in today's economic climate up to 2015. But I'd like to start in 1973. Now, I didn't watch this programme at the time. This is Jacob Bronowski, who made the great series The Ascent of Man. I watched it later, but it probably stands as one of the first great pieces of landmark television. At a time when I think there was still real optimism in society, this is a time just after the moon landings. This is a time when technology had delivered men to the moon and brought them back again. But Bronowski, even then, at quite high levels of investment in science, was pessimistic about the fate of the West and wrote a quite powerful piece, actually. This is the book, The Ascent of Man. I recommend that you get the series and watch it if you haven't seen it. It's a remarkable piece of television. But he said at the end, the 13th episode, they used to make 13 hours of television in those days. They only let me do five these days. Anyway, he wrote this. I'm infinitely saddened to find myself suddenly surrounded in the West by a sense of terrible loss of nerve, a retreat from knowledge into what? Into Zen Buddhism, into falsely profound questions about are we not really just animals, into extrasensory perception and mystery. They do not lie along the line of what we are now able to know if we devote ourselves to it, an understanding of man himself. We are nature's unique experiment to make the rational intelligence prove itself sounder than the reflex. Knowledge is our destiny, self-knowledge, at last bringing together the experience of the arts and the explanation of science, awaits ahead of us. It sounds very pessimistic to talk about Western civilization with a sense of retreat. I've been so optimistic about the ascent of man. Am I going to give up at this moment? Of course not. The ascent of man will go on. But do not assume that it will go on carried by Western civilization as we know it. We are being weighed in the balance at the moment. If we give up, the next step will be taken, but not by us. We have not been given any guarantee that Assyria and Egypt and Rome were not given. We are waiting to be somebody's past too, and not necessarily that of our future. Then actually, I'm going to read you the next, because it's beautiful. I wasn't going to read this, but he says here, we are a scientific civilization. That means a civilization in which knowledge and its integrity are crucial. Science is only a Latin word for knowledge. If we do not take the next step in the ascent of man, it will be taken by people elsewhere, in Africa, in China. Should I feel that to be sad? No, not in itself. Humanity has a right to change its colour. And yet, wedded as I am to the civilization that nurtured me, I should feel it to be infinitely sad. I, whom England made, whom it taught its language and its tolerance and excitement and intellectual pursuits, I should feel it a grave sense of loss, as would you, if 100 years from now, Shakespeare and Newton are historical fossils in the ascent of man, in the same way that Homer and Euclid are now. So, as I mentioned, I just wanted to show this picture. I mentioned that Bronowski was right in that, so semi-pessimistic. Not pessimistic about the fate of our civilization as a whole, it has to be said, but pessimistic about the West, about levels of investment, the value that we attach to knowledge here in the West. He was writing just after this picture was taken. This is the picture that was taken. It's very dear to me, this picture. It was taken on my first Christmas Eve. When I was less than 1 year old, Christmas Eve 1968 by Apollo 8, Earthrise, a very famous picture. I saw David Attenborough recently actually say that this was his favourite picture as a naturalist. Many people have said this photograph was the beginnings of the environmental movement because it's the first time that we saw the Earth as a rather fragile object hanging against the blackness of space rather than some kind of indestructible biosphere that will last forever. The picture has had great, powerful, emotional, political, and I suppose scientific influence in that sense. But also the Apollo program as an idea is interesting to study because I think that the common misconception about Apollo is that it was extremely expensive. It was, in some sense, Cold War, for the Cold War glorification of America and really didn't have much value and cost a lot and, you know, it ended probably at the right time. Interestingly, there are many studies that have been done about Apollo. The results are interesting. I'll mention in a minute that they may be semi-controversial, but it's worth looking at them. And I put this up. This is a quote from a NASA website of one of the several studies that were done of the economic impact of Apollo. This is the Midwestern Research Institute. I think the study was done in 1975. No, it was actually later, actually, because of the time. So it's done, yeah, after 1987. But they concluded that, so $25 billion in 1958 terms was spent on civilian space R&D during the 1959 to 69 period, during which Kennedy made his great speech, "We choose to go to the moon," and indeed went to the moon. Pictures like this were taken. They returned $52 billion into the economy by this research through 1970, and will continue to stimulate benefits through 1987 for a total gain of estimated $181 billion. So that's the origin of a very a famous point that's often made, that Apollo had a 7-to-1 return. There are other studies that give a return 10-to-1, even up to 14-to-1. Now, these findings are controversial. You find social scientists will argue about anything, and they do argue a lot about these figures. However, what does not seem to be debatable is that the economic impact of things like Apollo, of R&D, of basic research, tends to be positive. And many studies show it to be very positive. And I wanted to just read you two statements. One is, again, this is the political statement, this first one. It's from a man called Casimir, extremely famous theoretical physicist, but also went on to be research director of Philips. So he was also an extremely successful industrialist. And he appeared before the US Department of Commerce in 1966. So during this time, when America was spending large amounts on R&D and exploration, and he said this to the Department of Commerce committee when questions about the value of spending money on science. He said, "I've heard statements that the role of academic research and innovation is slight. It is about the most blatant piece of nonsense it's been my misfortune to stumble upon. I think there is hardly an example of 20th century innovation which is not indebted to basic scientific thought." And you see that over and over again. I'll quote one more thing because I'm in my serious mode, which was actually from, there's an excellent group, the Science and Technology Research Unit at the University of Sussex, who produces many reports into for the British government into, I suppose, the effectiveness of R&D investment. And they make, this is one of the latest papers actually, they make a very important statement over and over again, which I think politicians struggle to understand, but here it is. It's quite simple to understand. I don't know why they struggle. "Any attempt to assess and quantify the economic and social benefits from publicly funded research is beset by problems. Some of those are conceptual, related to the shortcomings of the linear model." This is the so-called linear model that generated those numbers, so there are debates about whether that works. "Others are methodological. Nevertheless, as previous reviews have documented, and this study further illustrates, a growing body of empirical work demonstrates that those benefits are substantial. Moreover, the benefits seem to be increasingly important as we move into a more knowledge-intensive and competitive era." In other words, it's very difficult to measure those numbers. It's very difficult to come up with numbers like that, other than to say that our technological civilization, our knowledge-based economy, is clearly built on it. And so, really, I mean, even those numbers may well be conservative. But anyway, let's take a look, just as a quick pointer to what we spend, just to set the context. This is a table from the OECD of figures that we spend on R&D in our economy as a percentage of GDP. These are the 2010 figures. They're ordered in order of spend, total spend. So you see Japan's at the top. Its government actually spends relatively little, about 0.56% of GDP, but its industry spends a lot. So in total, Japan spends 3.36% of its GDP on R&D in its economy. Germany, 0.91% of the government, 2.9% of GDP. France, 0.9% government, 2.26% when you take industry into account. Canada, 0.22, 1.8. UK, somewhere near the bottom of the league table, both in terms of government investment. Our government spends 0.57% of GDP on R&D, and indeed our industry, which is also bad. In total, we spend 1.77% of GDP, which is the same as China, and China is ramping up its investment quite spectacularly. Graphically, you can see it again. This is the percentage of civil R&D as a percentage of GDP. Iceland was at the top in 2009. We sweep down. It's Finland, Spain, Korea, Denmark, Portugal. We're all the way down. The EU 27 average is there. The OECD average is there. The United Kingdom, extremely low. Now, this, as I said, is the percentage of GDP spent on R&D. I remember once, I won't say who it was, but I was talking to a politician in 2009, I said, "Well, this is pathetic, isn't it? This is a reason to be embarrassed." And they said, "Well, actually, we've changed this now to some extent because we've ring-fenced the science budget and we've reduced GDP. So we should therefore be moving up the table," which is one way of doing it, not the way that I would. Anyway, moving up. So just those little figures. I know that there's a lot of figures there. The point is, and you can see it on this graph that I'm using as the timeline of my scientific life, is that we don't spend a lot by international measure, by any measure, on research and development on science in our economy. But as I'll show in a little bit later, we are extremely good in Britain at what we do with that money. But I just want to deviate a bit and move on, and I want to come to Carl Sagan again. I read something from Cosmos earlier about the great library at Alexandria, the value of promoting science. I thought I can never resist the temptation or the urge to play a little bit of Carl Sagan. So I want to play a little clip from Cosmos. The reason is that this came on television in 1979 or 1980, just about the time when I was 11 or 12 years old, when I was impressionable. I was always interested in astronomy. I think the Apollo program had something to do with it. But as an 11 or 12-year-old, you're at that point where you're going to go one way or the other. And fortunately for me, the 13 episodes of Cosmos came on the BBC. Anyone, I think, my age remembers Cosmos, remembers Carl Sagan. So I thought I'd just play the opening clip of the opening 2 minutes of Cosmos, because what Sagan says here is, I think, absolutely, well, it's vitally important to understand. It is the best explanation I know of why we do science. So let me play a clip of Carl Sagan with the music.
The cosmos is all that is, or ever was, or ever will be. Our contemplations of the cosmos stir us. There's a tingling in the spine, a catch in the voice, a faint sensation as if a distant memory of falling from a great height. We know we are approaching the grandest of mysteries. The size and age of the cosmos are beyond ordinary human understanding, lost somewhere between immensity and eternity is our tiny planetary home, the Earth. For the first time, we have the power to decide the fate of our planet and ourselves. This is a time of great danger, but our species is young and curious and brave. It shows much promise. In the last few millennia, we have made the most astonishing and unexpected discoveries about the cosmos and our place within it. I believe our future depends powerfully on how well we understand this cosmos in which we float like a mote of dust in the morning sky.
I love that. It's wonderful. Our future depends on how well we understand this cosmos. Absolutely right. Moving on, from then, if you watch that when you're 11 years old, then you are a scientist, pretty much, I think. There's nothing else you can do. You have to respond to it by saying, I want to be an explorer of the cosmos too. Just as I was doing my A-levels before I got distracted by Top of the Pops, which I'll mention in a minute, I discovered this man, Richard Feynman, who you discover again and again and again when you do a degree in physics. He is really the founder of modern quantum field theories, the foundation of our understanding of the subatomic world, without a doubt. A genius. If you've never read anything by Richard Feynman, some wonderful books. This is What Do You Care What Other People Think? There's also Surely You Must Be Joking, Mr. Feynman. I recommend it immensely. A genius by any stretch of the imagination. And I wanted to read you something here from the start of this book, What Do You Care What Other People Think?, that I read back then at some point in 1988, 1989. I get asked a lot by skeptics, or whatever you call them. Not those kind of skeptics, the skeptics in the pub people, the other ones that believe in UFOs and things. They ask me, well, what, you know, science, doesn't it take the magic away from your view of nature? You know, your scientists are always pulling things apart. You're trying to understand things, reduce things to simplest level. What about the beauty? What about the majesty? You're obscuring it somehow. And Feynman got asked that a lot, and he wrote a beautiful piece explaining precisely why that's bullshit. and I think it's beautiful. He says, I have a friend who's an artist, and he sometimes takes a view which I don't agree with. He'll hold up a flower and say, look how beautiful it is, and I'll agree. But then he'll say, I, as an artist, can see how beautiful the flower is. But you, as a scientist, take it all apart and it becomes dull. I think he's kind of nutty. I was finding when you have to do that in some New York accent, which I can't do, but anyway, I think he's kind of nutty. First of all, the beauty that he sees is available to other people, and to me too, I believe, although I might not be quite as refined aesthetically as he is. I can appreciate the beauty of a flower. But at the same time, I see much more in the flower than he sees. I can imagine the cells inside the flower, which also have a beauty. There's beauty not just at the dimension of 1 centimeter, there's also beauty at a smaller dimension. There are complicated actions of the cells and other processes. The fact that the colours in the flower have evolved in order to attract insects to pollinate it is interesting. That means insects can see colours. That adds a question. Does this aesthetic sense we have also exist in the lower forms of life? There are all kinds of interesting questions that come from a knowledge of science, which only adds to the excitement and mystery and awe of a flower. It only adds. I don't understand how it subtracts. Feynman, a genius. There's my band. Slight interlude I took through the early 90s. Went back to university at 23. And then my first bit of research, well, yeah, that's me. So a one-man hole in the ozone layer. I started my research at a particle accelerator here, actually in 1995. At this accelerator called HERA in Hamburg. And I thought just for a couple of minutes I'd give you a flavour of how I... Well, what research I did, because I really did find, actually, that... So I'd understood science in a sense that I understood the power of it, the beauty of it. I'd had the best teachers you can imagine, from Bernoski to Sagan to Feynman. But actually, that act of doing research, something that I still... I know some of my BBC friends are here. I'll be doing less telly because I'm doing more research. I apologise to you, because it's a very intoxicating thing to do. And I just thought I'd describe two bits of research that I did very briefly before I move on. As I said, I started my PhD here at HERA. HERA is an accelerator which accelerates protons one way. It's accelerated because it's no longer there. It functioned throughout the late 80s and early 90s onto the mid-90s. It took protons and accelerated them around the ring, and electrons and accelerated around the other side, or actually anti-electrons sometimes, positrons, antimatter electrons. Essentially an electron-proton collider, quite small compared to the Large Hadron Collider. That's the runway at Hamburg Airport. If you watched the World Cup in Germany a few years ago, that's one of the stadiums, the Hamburg football stadium there. So it was actually inside the HERA ring. And its job was to map the inside of the proton. So essentially this is an electron microscope. You collide electrons with protons. The electrons, you can think of them as emitting a very, very intense beam of very small wavelength photons of light, which then go into the proton. And you can resolve the innards of the proton. So here are mapped the inside of the proton with extreme precision, the highest precision maps we have even to this day. This is I love these 1980s graphics. They look very unimpressive now. But this is one of the detectors, I worked on called HERA. The idea is that the electrons come in that way, the protons come in that way, they collide in the middle, lots of new particles are produced. That's a person, so you get some sense of scale. And from this, you rebuild what happened in the collision. You can understand the physics of electron-proton collisions. I worked on a very interesting... to me anyway, and quite esoteric kind of collision. So this is a real picture of a real collision in this detector. So the electron comes in there, the proton comes in there, they hit each other. You think of the electron sending a photon off and going into the proton, if you like. That's what's drawn here, actually. So the electron comes in, hits a quark in the proton, which goes flying out. And what you see is the proton explodes, which is all this stuff here, because it's been hit by something very hard. You knock the quark out, or whatever it is that you hit, and that goes flying out into all this mess. This is the electron, which has bounced off and been detected in this detector here. So those events, millions and millions of them, you keep taking the photographs and you build up a map of the proton by analysing those things. I was interested, though, in this kind of thing, which you can see immediately is different. It's a very strange kind of thing. What's happened here, the proton has come flying in that direction, the electron's gone flying in that direction, and the proton seems to have vanished completely. Now, it hasn't vanished. What actually happened to it is it stayed intact. It got hit by something, which made a tremendous mess. The electron went flying out, but the proton itself stayed intact. And this is a picture of what those kind of collisions are, and they're very odd and very interesting. The picture is, in one kind of language called Reggie theory, is the proton comes along and some object floats up out of the proton, which has the properties of the vacuum, the properties of empty space. It's got no electric charge, so it just floats up, and the proton can float on unimpeded, losing some energy, which goes into this thing. And that thing is the thing that gets hit by the photon from the electron. It's a funny name, it's called a pomeron. It was actually named back in the 1960s, before we had a theory of this force of nature that exists, that holds protons together, called the strong force. And this is called the diffractive event. And to this day, they're of immense interest, because the nature of this thing, the pomeron, is interesting in itself. As I said, it's an odd thing, because it's essentially nothing. It's got the quantum numbers, the properties of nothing at all. And yet, it's certainly something, because all that mess there got knocked out of it when it floated up out of the proton. So I spent a long time investigating the structure of the pomeron. Completely useless, you might say, esoteric, but fascinating, because what you're really doing is studying the nature of the strong force of nature. There are four forces of nature. There's gravity, which is the weakest force of nature. The three other ones, which are quantum forces in the sense we have a quantum theory of them. Electromagnetism, we talked about that all the way back to Faraday and Maxwell. And then the strong and weak nuclear forces. The strong nuclear force is the thing that binds the proton together and binds protons and neutrons together inside your body to form atomic nuclei. And the weak nuclear force is the thing that's responsible for certain types of radioactive decay and is integral in the way the sun shines. It's the thing that allows protons to turn to neutrons inside the sun. So this is a part of the study of the dynamics of the strong force, if you like, esoteric physics. But I liked it. Called diffraction. I moved on, actually, to take this physics, which we haven't done yet, to the Large Hadron Collider. This is a proposal I worked on very much. The idea was that you could collide two of these pomerons together, essentially, one floating out of each proton. They're essentially nothing, so they carry the quantum numbers of the vacuum. And it turns out that you can make Higgs particles, we think, in these collisions, and keep the protons intact. So the proposal, which I worked on a lot, a thing called FP420, was actually to say, could we detect these two protons as they go flying out from the collision at the Large Hadron Collider? It turns out that if you do the maths, you find out that they would pop out ready to be detected almost half a kilometer away from where the protons collided. So it's a tremendously difficult experiment to do, but we think that can be done. And actually, there are still groups now, the one that I led, which is now morphed into a more sort of technical group, see if we can do it, who are actually looking at putting these detectors in the LHC, perhaps in, 5 or 10 years' time, to study the properties of the Higgs particle in immense detail in these kind of collisions. So that's a bit of fun about what I did in my research. I like pomerons, basically. Someone told me I should market them as little fluffy toys for kids. Pomerons. I think they're a good idea. Anyway, CERN. I mentioned CERN there. CERN's an interesting place, an interesting example of blue skies research. It was built in 1954 out of the Cold War. It was part of Europe's renaissance at the end of coming out of the Second World War to unify Europe together in for scientific research, actually. I've got a little quote here from the founding document, which is quite nice. It says that, what's the point of CERN? The organisation shall provide for collaboration amongst European member states in nuclear research of a pure scientific and fundamental character. The organisation shall have no concern with the work for military requirements, and the results of its experimental and theoretical work shall be published or otherwise made generally available. Blue sky science written down in the constitution of this organisation. This is the field in which CERN sits now. The most famous offshoot, of course, of this blue sky research was the World Wide Web, which was invented at CERN by Tim Berners-Lee and others in order to deal with the vast amounts of data that we generate in these particle collisions. And this is actually, I think it's a fascinating document. It was written in March 1989 by Tim Berners-Lee, you say it there. And it's basically a document to his supervisor, his line manager, his funding agency, if you like. And it says, information management, a proposal. It's the first presentation of this thing which would become the World Wide Web and revolutionise global commerce, amongst other things. And what I like a lot is that his line manager wrote vague but exciting on the top and gave it back to him, but allowed him to continue his work. I take from that every time anybody asks me to assess the impacts of my research, I should write vague but exciting and give it back to them. And I think that should be given 3 A-stars and it should be funded on that basis. CERN, very briefly, of course, famous for discovering the Higgs particle, which I think is one of the great scientific discoveries of all time, certainly one of the great scientific discoveries of the previous century. The Large Hadron Collider in itself is the most complex machine we've ever built. It accelerates protons to 99.999999% the speed of light, at which speed they circumnavigate this ring 11,000 times a second. It can create 600 million proton-proton collisions every second. In every collision, the conditions are recreated that were present less than a billionth of a second after the universe began, and it's the job of the experimenters at the Large Hadron Collider to take photographs of those collisions and look for new physics, like the Higgs particle, and also understand how the universe behaved, how the laws of physics manifested themselves less than a billionth of a second after the Big Bang. This is a photograph of the ATLAS detector. I showed you the H1 detector, that rather small old detector that I worked on doing my PhD in Hamburg. This is the ATLAS detector. There's a person stood there during construction. The mini Big Bangs happen in the centre of there, which is now filled with experimentation. This is a photograph, one of the photographs taken, which we are reasonably sure or is one of the Higgs discovery events that went into the Higgs discovery. You can never be sure that a particular collision has made a Higgs particle, but statistically, we now know we produce so many Higgs candidates that we are sure that there is a particle that behaves like the Higgs that has now been discovered. But this is the signature of one of them. The idea in itself is mind-boggling. Back in the 1960s, Peter Higgs and others predicted, for mathematical reasons, essentially for aesthetic mathematical reasons, that the universe is full of a condensate called the Higgs condensate. The picture is that less than a billionth of a second after the Big Bang, what's called a phase transition occurred. It's similar to water condensing out onto a pane of glass on a cold winter's day. You see ice forming. The water changes phase, changes state as it cools down. In a similar way, the picture is the universe expanded and cooled, and at some point the vacuum became filled with a Higgs field, with Higgs particles that are here now to this day. The vacuum is awash with them. Actually, if you naively calculate the energy contained in that Higgs field, you find in every cubic meter of space, there's more energy than the sun outputs in 1,000 years. In every cubic meter, inside this room, inside your head, and out to the most distant galaxies, the Higgs field is there. You get your mass at a fundamental level. The subatomic particles, like the electron that make up your bodies, get their mass from interacting with that Higgs field. That's a fundamental prediction. It's a very odd prediction. It turns out that's right. We now know, as of last year, that is a correct description of the way that nature is. And it came from mathematics, abstract mathematics, back in the 1960s, and it was discovered by the construction of the most complex machine ever built, which is a tremendous achievement. What I loved about Peter Higgs when he was at CERN last year and the announcement was made that this was correct, he said, "It's nice to be right sometimes." Wonderful. The discovery, I think, spawned a new generation in many ways of science superstars. This is one of my favourite pictures. This is my boss on the ATLAS experiment, the spokesperson of ATLAS, Fabiola Giannotti, who ended up on the front cover of Time magazine, the fifth most influential person of the year. in the Time magazine, an experimental particle physicist discovering something esoteric yet profound about the universe. So perhaps we're making progress. The Daily Mail even recognised the gravity of the situation. To begin to come to a conclusion then, I mentioned, I've shown you that graph all the way through, the declining levels of investment in science. Should we be pessimistic or optimistic here in the UK? Well, in many ways, there are signs that we should be extremely optimistic indeed. The foundations are there. I show you these figures, which are for physics applications, nationally and at Manchester, just because I'm at the University of Manchester, I have these numbers. It's interesting to note that since 2008, UK physics applications have been rising steadily. 3,651 in 2008, 5,500 in 2012. At Manchester, we've seen that. We had 870 applications in 2008. Now we've got over 1,000. We take, actually, slightly less than we did the year before because we're now in the game where we have such great students that we're trying to make sure that we're running out of lecturers, basically. So, interestingly, we could take more. We could take more students if we had more staff to teach those students to the standard which we think is appropriate. At Manchester, we take less than we could. So, what I take from this is that more investment will allow us to take more students and turn them into more scientists. But the trend for people wanting to be scientists is there for all to see. It's positive, it's optimistic. We are getting more applications, even in a difficult funding climate. Also, we are globally superb in the UK at research. This is a picture from a Royal Society report called the Scientific Century, actually, which you can download if you want more details from the Royal Society's website, which shows that with 1% of the population and 3% of the research funding, 8% of the world's scientific papers are produced in the UK, nearly 12% of the citations of those papers, and 14.5% of the most highly cited papers, so by this measure, the best scientific papers are produced in the UK. In other words, we are an efficient scientific nation, by some measures the most efficient, and we are also excellent. The reason for that is partly our scientific heritage and the excellence of our universities. This is the worst slide in the world, but it's full of information. It's from The Guardian. Actually, it took me a long time to get it off their website, so I assume that they didn't want anyone to copy it, so I don't tell anyone. It's interesting because I want to put that success in context and what I'm going to say at the end of the lecture, which is nearly now, in context. I'm going to call for an increase in science spending. Why is that? Because it's one of the UK's, if not the UK's, best industry in a sense. We are brilliant at higher education and at science, and it costs virtually nothing. This is called Spot the Science Budget. It's a game you can play. This is the total government spending. It's a great graphic, actually, in 2010-11. £691.67 billion, the total government spend. Spot the science budget. The science budget's that blob there. So that's what we spend. The area is proportional to what we spend. That's what we spend on research. This is what we spend on higher education in general. That's changed now because the tuition fees have come in, so it depends how you count it. Roughly speaking, we spend about £21 billion a year on the university sector, of which about £9 is tuition fees. So the government spends about £12 billion a year on universities. About £3 billion of that is research money that comes in, and about £9 billion is teaching, just to set the scale. So from that, we get something like 43, 44% of our economy, in the sense that the government figures show that 43, 44% of our GDP is what's called knowledge-intensive services and industry, which rests on that sector. So I would argue, well, it's certainly true that if you obliterated that bit, then the rest of it would essentially collapse, because 40-odd percent of our GDP is based on knowledge, which is based at its foundation on that piece of the thing. So what are we to do about that? What could happen? Well, here's my sort of final pitch to you. I decided what I would do is I would write the speech that I want a party leader to give on the eve of the 2015 election, based on the things that I've said, based on the fact that science is not only inspirational and fundamental to our civilization, but it's also a rather good investment. It underpins a large and increasing part of our economy. And I was given the idea for it by two events that happened. are two things that happened a couple of days ago, or last week. One was this, where you've seen on the news this remarkable meteorite that streaked across Russia, completely unseen until it detonated in the atmosphere with the force of several, I think it's 30 Hiroshima bombs, injured over 1,000 people. A couple of hours earlier, by the way, it would have done that over London, which may have injured rather more people. It wasn't seen. And the Russian Parliament's Foreign Affairs Committee chief said on Twitter, instead of fighting on Earth, people should be creating a joint system of asteroid defence. A very wise thing to say, because as Carl Sagan said, if the dinosaurs had had a space programme, they'd still be around. But the other thing was a piece by Andrei Geim, Nobel Prize winner, which I don't seem to be... Oh, there it is. Which he wrote in the Financial Times, coincidentally, just a few days before that meteorite happened, in which he dreamt. He'd been to Davos. Davos is, if you don't know, a place where social entrepreneurs, billionaires, go skiing and wander around being important, where there's a very famous... poet John Cooper Clarke said they mix with rock stars who are representing the interests, the global interests of the disenfranchised record-buying public, which I thought was very... people like Bongo, as he calls him. Anyway, if you know these, Bongo and the Hedge, he says. Anyway, Andre came back from that meeting and wrote in the Financial Times, "I have a dream. The Industrial Revolution and economic growth continue. This is because astrophysicists find a huge cosmic rock on course to hit Earth in 50 years. This should be scary enough. The world can surely deflect this threat, but we'll need to develop new knowledge and technologies. Finally, in my dream, humans realise social media can make some people very rich, but cannot save the planet. The latter requires new fundamental discoveries." So I took these two things and thought, what would my speech be like? What do I want a party leader to talk about? Well, this is the graph that I hope they're going to talk about. So this, in my life, stood here now in 2020. I would like to see the graph look like this. It's not a great deal to ask. I just think that we should double our spend, our public R&D spend, and we should double the spend that we spend on universities, and we should see what happens. It's a reasonable gamble. What this graph shows is that it seems that business investment seems to follow public investment, so we'll imagine that goes up as well. And that's my challenge. My challenge is that in 2015, a party leader, will it be that one, or that one, or that one? Who knows? Stands up and says this. I want them to say, we choose to make Britain the best place in the world to do science. Before this decade is out, we will ensure that every citizen will have the right to a university-level education, irrespective of their age or socioeconomic background, be it in the sciences, engineering, or arts. We will double our spending on universities and tertiary education. Why? Because I believe higher education is valuable to both the individual and to society. In my Britain, every citizen will have the opportunity to leave their hometown and be exposed to ideas. The environment of the university. Society is built on individuals. Imagine a Britain in which everyone you meet knows at least something of Plato, of Bach, of Picasso, of Newton, of Einstein, of Curie, of Archimedes, of Amis, of Mailer, of Mahler, of Dylan, of Lennon, of Feynman, of Sagan, of Armstrong and Aldrin, of Bronowski, of Davy, of Faraday. And further, a democratic society in which voters do not know what it is to make a scientific statement is ultimately doomed. Childhood vaccination policy, our response to climate change, questions about the efficacy of alternative medicines, these are not areas in which a simple opinion is valid. There is evidence, there are models, there is a vast amount of literature which at least defines an envelope within which valid policy actions fall. Column inches by old men whose opinions were once important do not define such an envelope. An educated and informed population is the only way to finally banish the demons of superstition hiding in the darkness. We will double our spending on research. This is Boris Johnson, perhaps, now. We will double our spending on research and introduce measures to make it attractive for industry to do the same, exceeding the investment in all our competitor nations. That, by the way, is all we would have to do that. We would have to restore R&D spend to 1970s levels when I was born. Why would we do that? because reaching for worlds beyond our grasp is an essential driver of progress and necessary sustenance for the human spirit. If we deny this innate and powerful urge, the borders of our intellectual domain will shrink with our ambition. We are that most rare and valuable part of the universe, a civilization, and our long-term survival depends solely on our understanding of nature. We will therefore join with our colleagues in Europe, Russia, the United States, and China in redirecting defense spending into the exploration of space to protect our planet from threats, mine asteroids for resources, and expand the frontiers of our civilization for the first time since Columbus. The citizens of our world, one amongst billions in the cosmos, will come together with the goal of expanding our understanding of nature for the good of all mankind. Today, we take our first step on our journey to the stars. And by the way, that's a fully costed policy. It'll increase public spending by about $20 billion a year by 2020, which will be offset by economic growth. Thank you.
You're okay for questions?
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. Vote for that.
Thank you, Brian. That was wonderful. Now time for some questions. We've got two microphones. I'd like you to put your hands up and wait till you get a microphone once I've directed it. So open for questions. And there's one there, and there's a microphone coming.
Mr. Rutherford. Professor. Dr. Rutherford.
I'll be a professor.
Sir, Adam Rutherford.
Just do that list of people that we need to be literate again.
Do the
list of people that we will be literate in again in 2015.
Oh, well, I missed out the biologists.
You missed out Darwin. Oh. Dear God, man.
Okay.
Moving rapidly.
It didn't rhyme.
In the front. Wait.
Yeah, Ian Fells from Newcastle. First of all, thank you for a marvellous lecture. I think we all enjoyed it tremendously. And if I made one little tiny point, and done without PowerPoint, which should be consigned to history, it just shows what you can really do when you do it like
thank
that.
You.
Can I just put in one little word for engineers? Who yes. you haven't mentioned during the course of the proceedings. And if you want people that really change the world and really produce GDP, you take somebody like George Stephenson, say, from where I come from, up in Newcastle, or the chaps that built the Hadron Collider, who are actually engineers, and all the rest of it.
I think the engineers,
we know physicists rule the world, and they're more important, more important than anybody else. But actually, in conjunction with the engineers, they're an essential part of it.
It's a very good point, actually. I was going to make some other points. I sort of overran a little bit. One of the points, though, is I agree with you completely. And I think that the kind of almost joke speech I gave at the end, actually, when you think about it, it's not that ridiculous, which is the point about it. Doubling our investment in research, which means, as you say, science and engineering and arts and humanities, I mean all the research councils, is not a ridiculous goal. But I think it will only happen if scientists, engineers, academics of arts, humanities, the lot, come together and lobby government with one voice. I really believe that. And I think one of the problems we've had in the past, particularly in CSR 2007, which should have been a wonderful CSR for everybody, one of the problems, physics had an immense problem. And it had problems, I think, because of lobbying behind the scenes. And we've not recovered from that. Even in the good times, we had a very bad funding settlement. And I think that it's wholly negative to bicker. So I agree with you completely. My statement is that it's the lot. Right? I'm not saying that it should be science. I'm certainly not going as fine-grained as physics, chemistry, and biology. I'm not even going as fine-grained as science, engineering, and the arts. I think we lobby as one for a knowledge economy. I really believe that very strongly. That's the way that we're going to do it. So thank you for the question.
We've got lots of questions over here. Walter, just here.
How do you explain in that nice graph of total GDP that way above the UK are Spain and Portugal?
In which?
You had that graph of the proportion of GDP, total spend on research.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's the...
How do you account for the fact that some of the rather less successful countries are apparently spending more?
Well, these are... I don't know. I mean, it's an interesting question. I mean, I would argue... A phalanx of historians and social scientists will tell me there's been many papers written on this, so I'm not going to guess. If I had to guess, I would say that it's to do with our heritage. As I said, we are the most efficient scientific nation in the world by many measures. And I do think it's down to, my instinct is it's down to organisations like the Royal Society, it's down to organisations like our universities, which are excellent. And I think that a lot of countries have been playing catch up, and it's very difficult to do.
Would we maintain that excellence if we double that?
Oh. I think we would be far more excellent. I think it's a very... Well, I think it's an... I do think it's an odd... I understand. I mean, at a more complex level, when you read research papers and you read a lot of the work that's done on R&D investment, I agree that it's a difficult problem. And the question, if government knew that investment in R&D would definitely lead to an increase in GDP, knew, I suspect they would do it. My pitch, though... is that let's look at the science budget. Science budget's what? Ring-fenced at 4.3, is it? 4.4 billion until 2015. So let's focus on that bit. Let's imagine that you decide to take the gamble and have a program to double the science budget, to restore it back to what it was in 1970 as a percentage of GDP. Then that would, over those years, integrate up to a 4 billion a year extra spend. What's the worst that can happen? The worst that can happen is you waste 4 billion, which is in the noise in government expenditure. It's probably in the exchange rate noise. What's the best that can happen? The best that can happen is you make Britain the best place in the world to do science and engineering, right? And you increase GDP at a spectacular rate, and you transform the fortunes of the country. Now, my 20 billion, also I'm imagining that you don't only do that, you say, I want every citizen to have access to tertiary education. Not university education necessarily, but tertiary education. Why do I say that? Well, if you look at the OECD figures, you find that over half the growth in the G20 nations over the last decade came from the tertiary educated sector. And if you integrate it up, so taking account of the big recession that we've had, all the growth in the UK economy from 2000 to 2010 came from the tertiary educated bit, which is not surprising because that's the bit that we can compete at. So that's why I argue that not only should we take the gamble of increasing research spend, I think we should take the gamble of saying, how could we pledge to make our workforce better in the tertiary sector? How do we get more people into the tertiary education sector? So I think it's you're right. If you could write it down in black and white and say, this is the increase in GDP from that R&D spend, social scientists argue about this all the time, other than to say that there's a positive correlation. But what the correlation is, they don't tell you. But I think it's a reasonable gamble, isn't it? Have a go. That's what I'm saying. Come on, George. Have a go. Make us the best place in the world to do science and engineering and see what happens.
I'm going to take two more questions, one here and the second there.
Much to my delight, you mentioned the Royal Institution more times than I could count. And, of course, one of the things the Royal Institution pioneered, and I think particularly Faraday, was not just engaging with the public, but really engaging with children. And we know that children at a certain age, 7, 8-year-olds, are very enthusiastic about science, and yet somehow by the time they're 16, a lot of them have lost that enthusiasm. Mm. What do you think goes wrong, and what do you think we should do differently?
Well, my area of expertise is not with 16-year-olds, so it's anecdotal, my evidence. I don't know what the data is. Anecdotally, though, and I do go into schools and I give big schools talks, and I find real enthusiasm all the way through the age. I gave a talk recently associated with something called the Big Bang Fair, which is a big event that goes on at Excel, and a school have won a talk from me, and that was a 13-14-year-old age group. And when I said who would like to be a scientist, about half the hands went up, and I find that's my experience. So I'm not sure anything does go wrong. as I said, it seems that applications are up. I think that we could take more scientists into the university sector than we can possibly do, because we haven't got enough staff, we haven't got the lecture theatres, you know, we haven't got the commitment from government to fund that, although that is changing. I don't want to be too negative about this government's performance. I mean, I didn't say some of the figures are relatively impressive. £1 billion has come back into capital expenditure, for example, that was cut under the previous government. So the flat cash settlement, although it's going to result in something like a £600 million drop in the science budget by 2015, is still flat cash. So I don't want to be too negative about it. I think it's about messaging in a way. I mean, one of the reasons I've written quite often that I think someone, and George Osborne did, stood on this stage, I think, and said, we will make Britain the best place in the world to do science. One of the reasons is I think that filters through. So I get the sense when I talk to some kids that a lot of them, you hear, I'd love to be a scientist, but I'm not clever enough, or I'd love to be a scientist, but it's too difficult, or, you know, I don't think I could get there. So the messaging, first of all, it isn't too difficult. You don't have to be a genius. It's for boys as well as girls, of course. And if you do it, then if you want to dream, if you want to be an astronomer or a particle physicist or an aero engineer, you want to build satellites, you want to, you know, as we're doing with ExoMars, you want to go and work on that with Astrium or whatever you want to do, then those things are available to you. Those jobs are there. I think that's very important, and that's part of it. And that's why, as for many other reasons, cutting PhD places is idiotic. Because that messaging says that you've got to be brilliant, you've got to be in the top 0.001% or whatever to get through to go and work at CERN. But everyone goes, I went into physics, actually I went to be an astronomer, I did astrophysics initially. I went into physics to work at Jodrell Bank. That's actually what I wanted to do, because I used to visit Jodrell Bank as a child. I think we've got to, when you build this ecosystem and you start providing proper numbers of PhD places, which we don't do, they're reducing, which is idiotic for so many reasons, and we start giving that message out that you can be that thing that you dream about, I think you'll get the flow. I've no doubt that the enthusiasm's there, but it's just about simple messaging, and probably the main one, as I say, is you can, it can be done, you can do it, there are places if you want.
And our last question here.
Hi, I'm going to ask you a very leading question. Do you think it's enough to merely increase the amount of spend on science, or do you think we also need to restructure the way that money is allocated? I'm just thinking, at the moment, certainly in my field, the trend is very much you have a 3-year grant, a 4-year grant, which means that 2 years into your current research, you're already having to kind of divert time from the day-to-day business of doing science to writing your next grant proposal and thinking about how you're going to sell that. It seems to me that a more efficient way to do it is to trust people to do the best science in the same way that, you know, the Royal Society is good at this. They trust their fellows to just do the best science. But I don't think that's the way the larger scientific funding community is set up at the moment.
Yeah, I agree completely. I mean, I should say, I mean, I benefited hugely from the Royal Society's University Research Fellowship Scheme, which meant that so I'm in my 8th year now, so I finished this year. But the first 5 years before I started making television programs seriously, I worked on this thing I just mentioned, this FP420, this diffraction idea at the LHC, which is probably going to go ahead at some point in the future. The documents are there, the research has been done. I had freedom to do it, and I only had to put grant proposals in for the money to build it from PPAR, because it was then an STFC, and not for my career. So my career was essentially defined. Also, when you get a URF, then you get tenure, essentially, or you should do at the university. It's not guaranteed, but as we all know, that's the idea of the scheme, isn't it? To create scientific leaders. So I agree with you completely. I think that it goes back to the question that you asked about would doubling the research budget do anything? Would, you know, what would you do with the extra money? There's accountability for public money. But I agree with the sentiment of your question entirely, that it seems to me to have been demonstrated, it's obvious time and again, in study after study and historically, that R&D is a positive benefit to society. Obviously, scientists and engineers drive innovation in society. And the more you shackle them and the less exploration they do, because the more form filling they do, then the less value for money you'll get. It seems to me completely obvious. And I think, you know, I could go further, but it's on the web and things. I mean, I just find it ridiculous. I speak to colleagues who, talking about the REF and things like that, who say that they spend, let's say, 5% of their academic time filling in those forms, right? So that means that by abolishing something, probably more, by abolishing those things, you could increase the productivity of UK academia by 5% with the stroke of the pen, seems to me. Why, you know, if you said in any other way, I know how to increase productivity by 5 or 10%, you'd do it. Now, that might not be popular, and there are probably, I don't know, but I agree with you completely. I think that we're demonstrably efficient and excellent and contribute a great deal to the country, and I think people should stop making us fill in forms and let us get on with it. There we are.
So clearly that's our last question. I want to thank the audience, both here and in the overflow rooms, for coming. I want to thank those on the web for listening, but most of all, I want to thank Brian for a great Royal Society Michael Faraday lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.